Panel on space exploration, we had a small subcommittee, and we discussed who would we want on that dream team of panelists. I'm happy to say today that we indeed have that dream team of panelists. And at this time, I'd like to introduce our very distinguished panelists. Brigadier General Charlie Duke is a retired U.S. Air Force reservist and an Apollo astronaut. He graduated valedictorian from the Admiral Farragut Academy in St. Petersburg, Florida, received a Bachelor of Science in Naval Sciences from the U.S. Naval Academy, and a Master of Science degree in Aeronautics from MIT. He holds honorary doctoral degrees from the University of South Carolina and Francis Marion University. In 1966, General Duke was one of 19 selected to be part of NASA's fifth group of astronauts. He served as a member of the astronaut support crew for Apollo 10 flight. For Apollo 11, which was the first landing on the moon, he was the capsule communicator, or CAPCOM, in Houston. In fact, his voice was out of mission control, talking to Neil Armstrong on the moon. For Apollo 13, he served as backup lunar module pilot and was called upon in Houston to help provide critical solutions to bring the crippled spacecraft safely back to Earth. In April 1972, General Duke served as lunar module pilot of Apollo 16, and he was the 10th person to walk on the moon. Please let's welcome General Charlie Duke. Former U.S. Marine Corps aviator and a 1989 graduate of the Citadel, where he studied mathematics. After graduation, he commissioned as an officer to the U.S. Marine Corps. While a Marine, Colonel Bresnik earned a Master of Science in Aviation Systems from the University of Tennessee and graduated from the Air War College. In 2004, he was among the elite few selected out of approximately 3,500 applicants to become one of the 11 members of NASA's Astronaut Class 19. In 2009, Colonel Bresnik was part of the Space Shuttle Atlantis crew that docked with the International Space Station for 11 days. He had two spacewalks during that mission and totaled 11 hours and 50 minutes. Colonel Bresnik will soon assume command of the International Space Station, leading an international team for Expedition 52-53, expected to launch from Russia early in the summer. Colonel Randy Bresnik is joining us from Russia. Please, let's welcome him.
Sounds like somebody turned off a microphone close to the podium and got a little more muffled, but it was good initially. Thank you, everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Dr. Noah Petro is a planetary geologist at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center in Greenville, Maryland. His passion for the moon is in his DNA. His father was an engineer who built parts for the Apollo lunar module and the astronauts' backpacks. In high school, Dr. Petro was introduced to the world of geology, and later at Bates College was introduced to the world of planetary geology. He earned his PhD from Brown University in 2007. He has worked on the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, or LRO, since 2011, and is helping plan for future lunar missions to the moon's far side. Please let's welcome Dr. Petro. Director Stephen Odendahl is a NASA mission director and a 1985 graduate of the Citadel, where he majored in physics. Following graduation, he commissioned as a second lieutenant in the U.S. Air Force and moved to Colorado Springs, beginning training as a satellite operations officer. Director Odendahl completed three demanding assignments while serving in the Air Force and eventually earned his master's degree in space systems management from Webster University. In 2001, he began working for NASA as a mission director for the three spacecraft in the International Solar Terrestrial Physics Program. Director Odendahl served as mission director for a variety of heliophysics and astrophysics spacecraft before taking on the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter in 2010. In addition to his position as LRO mission director, he trains and mentors new mission directors and sits on various NASA review boards for missions in development. Let's welcome Director Stephen Odendahl. Veronica McNerney is a senior physics major at the Citadel. Cadet McNerney is originally from Las Vegas and is expected to commission in the U.S. Air Force upon graduating in May to begin space systems operations training. She is a Citadel scholar, a member of the Citadel Honors Program, an editor for the Shaco, and the first sergeant for Victor Company. She serves as a research assistant for the Planetary Science Institute and is engaged in ongoing work with the ATSA Suborbital Observatory, project led by Citadel Physics Professor Luke Solid. Cadet McNerney has been reporting on Colonel Bresnik's training expedition through her blog called the Citadel Space Star Cadet Blog. Let's welcome Cadet McNerney. Over for the next 10 minutes or so to Dr. Pietro, who is going to give us a presentation on the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. This is one of the most impressive crowds I've ever had the opportunity to speak in front of, and push the microphone closer.
There you go.
And with Charlie Dugan in attendance, I can't start any talk without presenting a picture of the Apollo 16 landing site as taken by the spacecraft Steve and I get to operate. This is an image, I call it the out of the airplane view image. We slew the spacecraft to the side to get this oblique view. Charlie landed, it doesn't appear on the screen here, but right essentially in the middle of the image, the bright crater you see to the left here, South Ray crater. Basically for perspective, the distance covered between the feature shown at the left and the large crater right above Steve Odenell's head there is about the distance, length of the Charleston Peninsula that we're sitting on today. So it gives you a sense of scale. Now, Charlie and John Young drove over the course of three EVAs between these two craters here. So that was one of the most impressive excursions of Apollo. And one of the great joys of working on LRO is not only exploring future landing sites that we hope to one day go to, but also looking back and revisiting places that we've been. So let's just take a step back for a moment. You might think, why did we send an orbiter to the moon? So in January of 2004, President Bush announced his vision for space exploration. And one of the parts of that vision was to return humans to the lunar surface by 2020. And as NASA likes to do, whenever they're given the direction, they get a panel of scientists together, and that panel identified several key measurements that we had to make first before sending humans back to the moon. We needed to basically make sure that radiation would not be a critical hazard for long duration human exploration. We needed to find basically where the safe landing sites were. So that required producing a global topographic map with enough accuracy to pinpoint any location on the lunar surface. For LRO, there were errors in essentially the topographic grid of the moon on order of a few kilometers places on the far side of the moon. That meant that with the maps that we had at the time, we didn't know where things were within an order of a few kilometers, and that would, of course, have been problematic for any future missions. We wanted to map where hydrogen was, and you might think, why hydrogen? Well, hydrogen in the form of water, before LRO, was thought to exist near the lunar poles, and so LRO was sent to chart where we might find water at and near the surface to use for future landing missions. We wanted to produce high-resolution temperature maps so we could identify areas where water may exist below the surface in ice form. We wanted to take images of areas inside permanent shadow. There are craters at the poles of the moon that never receive direct solar illumination. And these were identified as critical targets for future resource utilization on the lunar surface. Mapping near-surface ice, characterizing illumination conditions of the polar regions. We knew that the poles were places we wanted to go, but we wanted to find areas that may have more illumination than others. Are there any places near the poles that receive continuous illumination for the 28 Earth days of lunar day? And find also those areas that were never illuminated. And then take images of the lunar surface at meter and submeter scales for future landings. And that was the objective of that camera, the image of which I showed before. So these were sort of the order of the day for the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter mission before we launched. Can't talk about a launch without showing it. This was in June of 2009. I was not at the launch. I was actually one of the only people left behind at Goddard to explain what we were doing to the assembled masses there. And that was the last time the spacecraft ever was sitting still. We've been going now for over 7 years, which is no small accomplishment, keeping a spacecraft alive. And that's one of the responsibilities Steve has, is to constantly remind scientists like me that no, you can't do that, you'll break the spacecraft. And as much as we've tried, Steve has prevented us from doing any damage to the spacecraft. And so, thank you, Steve. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about Apollo for a moment here, and you know, why do we take images of the Apollo landing sites? Why do we pay attention to those places anymore? Well, you know, these six Apollo explorations in the lunar surface provide a critical understanding of lunar geology. I mean, apart from the Earth, the Moon is the best studied planetary body we have. We have samples from the Moon in Earth labs. It tells us something fundamental about how planets work. So the Moon is the cornerstone for understanding how planets work. We saw beautiful images of Pluto last year, or 2 years ago. You know, those images were analyzed, but with an eye towards the Moon, because our understanding of the Moon is how we interpret any planet in the solar system, Pluto, Mars, and everything in between. The Moon, because it's essentially in our backyard, is a great way to study early solar system processes. When I look at the lunar surface, I see essentially a complete record of the solar system from just after formation to today. Now that record is largely gone on Earth because thankfully we have an environment that with weather, erosion, that erased that record, but that early solar system record is preserved on the lunar surface. And lastly, you know, understanding what Charlie and the other Apollo astronauts did on the surface, the context of where that sample came from, where the Big Muley rock actually came from, what its origin is, helps us better understand those samples. And as a geologist, knowing the exact context of each of those samples is critically important. Now, each of the Apollo astronauts took great painstaking care to document those samples, and now with the data from LRO, that context that they were collected in can be enhanced. This is a picture that, if you ever look through the Apollo archive, you know, there's many beautiful images, but there are some that were less beautiful. Every picture taken on the lunar surface is beautiful for various reasons, and there's Charlie in one of the great moments on lunar surface exploration right there. Here's the picture, the famous picture of the Duke family that still sits on the surface today. We can't see this image, the picture that Charlie took, we can't see that picture, but we know exactly where Charlie took that picture. Again, the context of that picture being valuable. Here's the medallion, the gold, the coin that was left behind on the lunar surface by Charlie. And just as a step back, you know, now we have this amazing photography of the lunar surface. That wasn't always the case. This is an image that was taken by the Apollo 14 mission in preparation for Apollo 16. And then the landing site for Apollo 16 is in the middle of these two bright craters. And to the north, this is a crater called North Ray Crater. Geologists are very clever when coming up with names. South Ray and North Ray Crater. This is the zoom in of that image, and you may see at about the 4 or 5 o'clock position, a smudge, a black dot. That's something we call house rock. It was a target for the third EVA on Apollo 16. And one of the sort of the conundrums that we come into with exploration is, you know, we wanted them to go there. Let's go back in time and sit in for a moment with the geology back room as Apollo 16 was unfolding. And you're going to hear a conversation. Trying to understand where they were. So these are the people who are making sure the geology gets done. The astronauts got up to go to the house rock. They thought they were right next to it. But this was the largest boulder ever visited on Apollo. Judging distances on the lunar surface is very difficult. And so he goes closer. Here, in their voices, this conundrum of where are they?
Here's what they're going to look like when they stand next to it. Here's what they're going to look like when they stand next to it.
It's the biggest block on the photograph.
Is that right? You do see on the photograph.
We don't have a pad of bag with them, do they?
That big black dot.
Fantastic. right here. That is magnificent. And where are they? They must be planning right here.
And the build is supposedly 15-meter resolution.
So they're in about that position.
They're closer in. By scale, they're probably about a year, and then they're walking over to them.
And now in the second place.
And as our crew slowly.
Yeah, oh, no, Bill. No, I don't think that.
A little contrast to what you see in Mission Control.
Yeah, we do.
One of the. Comments that is in the background of that is as John and Charlie are exploring the surface, they're getting up to House Rock. They say, oh, look, there's some area in permanent shadow there. We should sample that. And you hear someone say, ah, attaboy. Because these are the people who trained Charlie and John and the other astronauts in the geology that they would then apply to the lunar surface. So one of the things that we wanted to avoid with, in future exploration is that, or improve upon, is that situational awareness. Here's the Apollo 14 image. Here's a one frame from the LRO camera. Here's House Rock again at about 5 o'clock on that image there. Again, the detail that we can make out in these images will really greatly enhance future exploration of the surface. Zoom in on there, and while you can't see the boot prints or rover prints in this particular image, House Rock again just slightly off to the side there. This is an image of the landing site, the land descent stage at the center there. You can see the rover tracks at the right-hand side. That's the lunar rover, still parked on the lunar surface. And just at about 11 p.m. from the lunar module is a black spot. That's the shadow of the American flag, which is still standing on the surface of the moon today. In fact, at Apollo 14, 15, 16, and 17 sites, we can still see the shadow of the flag. I'm running long over time now. And there's the flag, and there's Charlie standing on the surface just about 45 years ago. And so with that, I thank you for your time and attention, and look forward to the rest of the panel session.
Thank you. Let's go back to the split screen and talk about resiliency. So, the definition of resiliency, to get the panel started, the ability to recover from or adjust easily to misfortune or change. When I started thinking about how I should approach asking questions on resiliency, it struck me that there are really two different concepts within that definition. One concept is the ability to adjust to change, or the ability to easily adjust to change. And the other one is the ability to recover or easily recover from misfortune. So I thought we would talk about both of those. Even though they overlap, I think it's important to sort of separate them initially. And so with that in mind, we're going to talk about the ability to adjust to change first. And the first question I have for the panel: in any career path, one needs to have the ability to adjust to change and to adjust professional skill sets. However, with space exploration, this is especially true. Spacecraft technology is ever-changing, computer technology and software is changing, missions change. And so I would like each of the panelists to take a moment to describe an example of when in their professional career they've had to adjust to change. We'll start first with Director Odendahl.
Thank you. It's hard to pick one particular instance to say where I had to adjust to change. Basically, my whole career has been an adjustment to change, and I think everybody knows that over my 30 years plus in the space business, computer technology has grown tremendously. I mean, if you think back to the computers that ran the Apollo missions, and how rudimentary they are by today's standards. My career started with the launch and early orbit of Global Positioning System spacecraft back in the late 80s, And the computer we had on board that spacecraft was very rudimentary too by today's standards. We had no safe mode for the spacecraft. There was nothing that the spacecraft would do autonomously at all. It was all done by ground command. The telemetry points we had were, we numbered about 500 various telemetry points up per spacecraft. And then over the course of that 30 years, half that time, when I finally went as a contractor to NASA in 1993, we began to see microcomputers coming out with solid-state recording devices. That was brand spanking new then, so we didn't have tape recorders, and GPS had no recorders whatsoever. And then, of course, the ground technology has also improved. In GPS, we had a back room, computer room with direct access storage devices. I mean, it was a room the size of this auditorium just to handle the computer systems. Now we do it with laptops. The spacecraft are so autonomous that they can put themselves into a safe mode if anything goes wrong that we can foresee anyway. And now we have systems that can page our spacecraft operators the minute it sees a problem, whereas during my early career, we ran spacecraft operations 24/7. Now it's 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, normal operating times. So the people aren't working rotating shifts. Our size of our crews are smaller now because we have such, you know, the big impacts due to computer technology. So that's a cost savings. Just tremendous changes over the whole scope of how satellite operations are done now, as opposed to when I first started 30 years ago. Biggest change in how we have to adjust.
Colonel President?
Well, I'm lucky that right now I'm living a big change, and it's more the human side of it. You know, the space station's been up there since 2000. We've had a continuous human presence in space for the last 17 years. And we do that by sending crews up there for about 6 months. And we rotate the crews out, and so with two sets of overlapping crews that are, you know, overlapping by about 3 months, that means we have four launches a year. Well, for the past 16, 15, 16 years, those launches have been pretty well defined and well scheduled, and gone off like clockwork. So you kind of plan for that, and the training plan, you know, it's a long, you know, year and a half to 2 years of training to get prepared. Training, you try and get so that because you're going to be up there for 6 months, to where, like any highly efficient organization, you try to get to where you really know the people well. You train together, you try and figure out, hey, what makes this person tick? How do you, you know when they're getting tired or they're getting frustrated? How can you help them? We call it expeditionary behavior. And so we get put together on our crews and start out training together, and we do stuff outside of work, inside of work, so we get to know the people really well. Well, last fall, after over a year of training, all of a sudden we made some change to the schedule. Our partners decided to go from three crew on orbit to two crew, so they ended up moving up some crews that were already in training. And so I went, instead of from a November of 2017 launch, I moved up 6 months to a May of 2017 launch. And I found that out about a year prior to launch. So what I was originally planned. So instead of being a year from launch, I was suddenly a year from landing. And you can imagine, you know, for a mission this long and this big and this complex, you know, some of your most important training is in that last year. And all of a sudden, we had 6 months to do the training. Not to mention the fact that it was the Soyuz commander and I that moved up from November, and so we lost our right seater, who was a Japanese astronaut, and we moved into a spot where there was an Italian one. Well, just this afternoon, that Italian astronaut and my Russian Soyuz commander and I, we trained in the Soyuz sim for a launch and entry type of sim, and that was only the second time we've ever trained together. And our Italian crewmate leaves to go home back to the U.S. tomorrow, and then we'll all come back together here in the end of June to go through our prime launch flow. And that'll be, you know, where we do our final qualifications, and we've trained together for two sims. So that's pretty astounding. Even the fact that when I'm commander of the space station around the September time frame, when the crew comes up to join us, we just 2 weeks ago we had a third crew member added to that. So now instead of five crew members on orbit during that time frame from about September to December, we now have six, and a crew member that hasn't trained with any of us. So that's where we talk about being able to adapt to change. that's where your professionalism and your training kicks in, and you really just have to trust that you've got good expeditionary behavior that'll work with anybody that you go ahead and have the opportunity to work with.
Yeah, thank you. That's a great example of resiliency. General Duke, would you like to address that question?
Yeah. I think one of the areas in my career as an Apollo astronaut came on Apollo 13. I was backup crew for Apollo 13, and back in Apollo, we had two crews. We had a prime crew that was going to fly the mission and a backup crew that would take their place if they had an accident, crashed or broke a leg or something. The idea was to change the whole crew so they wouldn't slip the schedule. Well, about 10 days or so before the flight, I catch the measles. Exposed everybody to the measles, and the NASA doctors were stunned, to say the least. You know, kids get the measles. What are you doing with the measles? And well, I had the measles and was pretty sick. So, what are we? So they checked everybody for the measles, and there was one guy on the prime crew that had never had the measles. So he was. The doctor says he's going to get the measles at the moon, and he could be really sick, and so we're not going to let him go. Well, wait a minute, you're going to have to cancel the flight. And so the change happened, and overcoming that was our training was so rigorous and identical that our director of flight crew operations said, well, why don't we take Mattingly off the flight and put Jack Schweikert into his place. And so he talked to Jim Lovell, the crew commander, and said, well, you guys got a week. If you're not ready to go in a week, we go cancel this thing. And sure enough, that change occurred in the crew, and it was okay. And they were ready to go. Then Mattingly so came back on our crew, and we had to sort of start adjusting our personalities, if you will, to this change in crew. Everybody has a different personality, and so you've got to learn how to meld personalities into your organization, into your crew, in a short period of time. And it wasn't critical for us, except for when the accident occurred on Apollo 13, we had to respond quickly and get to mission control to overcome that catastrophic incident on Apollo 13 where the oxygen tanks blew up and they lost all their oxygen electrical power and command module. So that was just one of the examples of overcoming change that we experienced in Apollo.
Thank you, General Duke. Dr. Petra, do you have an example?
Adjusting to talking after two astronauts, maybe one of the things I'll have to learn right now. Maybe on a slightly different tack, having children. That was obviously a big change, still is. Every day is a new adventure. But now, in all seriousness, one of the things that I've had to adjust to, and one of the themes that is cropping up is this idea of being on a team. Importance of teamwork and being part of a team requires leadership. And as I've moved up in the ranks within the mission, within the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, to now being not quite second in command, because Steve is still first in command, but the deputy scientist basically for the mission is going from a position of looking up to other people for guidance and to being in a position where folks are looking to me for guidance. And that's been an amazing challenge. I've enjoyed it. Taking on that responsibility means that there's added pressure every day, having to answer emails not only from science team members who are angry that they can't get their measurements made because the spacecraft just is, you know, to make that measurement would put the spacecraft at risk. Emails from above, from NASA headquarters, why aren't your team spending their money faster? Why aren't you? And managing that balance of being a strong leader of
the science team, but also of sort of supporting the engineers who work on the missions. Perhaps one of the greatest changes that I've had to go through, because for years I was very comfortable looking up to other people for guidance. And then once those eyes fall to you, whether it's your team members or your children's eyes looking up to you, that puts you sometimes in uncomfortable positions. But when you surround yourself with people, and as has been mentioned a number of times, when you surround yourself with people that you enjoy working with, that you develop relationships with, you can overcome those hurdles. And so, you know, one of the things that's best prepared me for that is just surrounding myself with people that I enjoy working with, because then those challenges become at least more tolerable.
Dr. Brown
and
Gary, did you
want
to follow up?
I do have a follow-up question for General Duke. I read your book. I really enjoyed Moonwalker. And there are a number of things that I learned in that book, but one that applies in a slightly different way than what we're talking about here is your transition from being a very great student at the Naval Academy to your experience at MIT when you were pursuing a master's degree in aeronautics and astronautics. And you mentioned, well, of course, you were also in the process of finding your wife, and so your mind was off your studies at times, but nonetheless, you point out something very interesting about the difference in the education model between an undergraduate military institution and an institution like MIT. I was wondering if you would address that.
That was a real challenge, of course. I graduated in 1957 from the Naval Academy, and we had a general engineering degree. And at the Naval Academy, the process was they taught you the material in class, and then on the exams, you just, how did you learn that material, and how did you not apply that material, but how did you answer the questions on the test that were covered in class. And so it was basically feeding back what you learned in class. And at MIT, it was totally different. I remember in my electrical engineering book from the Naval Academy, there was a new invention called transistors. And it was, I just remembered that word. Well, 5 years later, when I get back to MIT, they assumed you knew how to work, I mean, all about transistors and all of these changes that had occurred. And so they taught you theory at MIT, but your quizzes were not on the theory, it was how you applied the theory. And that was the challenge. And it was totally different. I didn't have to memorize it. In Naval Academy, if you memorize the facts, you were going to get a good grade. At MIT, you had to understand the theory, understand the facts, and how you apply that for the for your exams. And I can remember, and I don't remember what class it was, but in one class, our class average was 8. Out of 100, and I was like 4, so I get a B or something like that. And I mean, it's really humiliating to go into the class, and you could have a wheelbarrow full of open books, it wouldn't do you any good. It was just, and people were thumbing through the books trying to find something that would apply to this question, and the curtains were flapping in the breeze, generating so much wind in the and so it was a challenge to understand. And I was on the Air Force required a B average, but I had a C minus the first semester. Well, you're on probation. And I pulled it up just a little bit the second semester. I pleaded with them, let me stay another semester. And my wife and I were, now my wife, we were courting pretty heavy, and that might have something to do with it. discovered my niche was Apollo actually had the MIT had the contract from Apollo to build Apollo guidance and navigation system. And so that was my thesis, to do a statistical analysis on whether astronauts could really operate this system. And so grades started coming up, and I started understanding what it was all about, and ended up getting my degree, thank the Lord.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question. Part of the driver for some of these changes in professional skill sets has been the result of NASA, as a federal agency, having to change. Almost with every administration, NASA's mission and priorities change. I was wondering if the panelists could provide some insight as to how NASA has had to adjust to changing administrations. And for this question, I'd like to start with Colonel Bresnik.
All right. You guys got slide one up?
Yes.
All right.
This is the
I like this slide. Somebody.
This is the library.
Somebody,
slide.
Pat.
Excuse me.
You want me to proceed?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, all right. Because it really frames this whole, in answer to this whole question. You know, we built our last U.S. space vehicle and started flying in the early 80s. Do the math, that's 3.5 decades that we've been a country of PowerPoint space vehicles, human space vehicles. And so you can see the names, you know, those of you that are more experienced and have a little more history in our, you know, in our space program, you can see all the names and stuff that look really familiar. Programs that we got started had showed great promise, but then we ended up, you know, canceling them when somebody else had a better idea or a better PowerPoint presentation. And hundreds of millions and billions of dollars that we've invested, you know, Constellation program alone, I was working that in the early 2000s after I became an astronaut. And we got a new administration in 2009 and canceled it, and we already had $6 billion of work into it. Some of it we were able to transfer, but, you know, not all of it. So that's why it's really exciting now that we are actually have vehicles we're bending metal on, and we're going to build the, you know, Orion capsule being built by Lockheed that'll be our beyond low Earth orbit vehicle. We've got the SpaceX company building the Crew Dragon, and we got the Boeing company building the Starliner. You know, we need to get these things flying, and if they're not perfect, no space vehicle ever is, but then we make them better, and we're really good at that. We've done that with all our vehicles throughout the history of our space program. You go on to the next slide. Why is that important? So you see the boats in that picture, and the one in the bottom left, that's a model of the Mayflower. The other one is a model of a country, in the large country in the Far East, in the Orient, that was a similar type of a vessel of the same time frame. And you can see the size and scale and magnitude and complexity difference between those two sets of vehicles. I'm not putting this out there to, you know, suggest a new space race, but the point is we invest our treasure as far as money, our efforts, our intellectual, you know, pursuits, and our passions as a country. We made that, you know, incredible investment back in the 60s with our Apollo space program. And look at what it's bought us over the last 3.5, 4 decades as far as the technologies that we were able to get from that and utilize still today. Well, if other countries are investing more in their space programs than we are now, well, they can probably expect bigger results than what we would possibly expect. Is that a position that we want to be in as a nation? Next slide. This one is a good picture of all the places that our federal government dollars go to. And you can see that red arrow at the bottom right side pointing to a little tiny NASA symbol. And NASA is about 0.5% of the federal budget. And when you think of all the stuff that the government does, how much stuff, how many operations, how many programs, how many things are looking 10, 20, 30 years down into the future and trying to make us have a destination that we can go to rather than trying to put out the club, the alligator closest to the boat, you know, today and tomorrow. That, you know, 0.5% of the budget equates to about $58 per American. So if you're in, you know, perhaps South Carolina or Houston, that's, you know, about 2 tanks of gas. If you're in California or New York, it's like 0.5 tank of gas. But imagine what we could do with, you know, 2 tanks of gas, you know, in California with our NASA budget. I mean, it's amazing what our little tiny agency does with less than $20 billion a year. We could do a lot more and be able to have more of a destination in the future if we were just able to have more continuity and stick with the programs we've already invested our money in and see them to fruition. It would be nice if we had a NASA administrator that we could have for 10 years, kind of like the FBI does. But we change them every 4 years or whenever we have an administration change. So it's something to think about. Thank you.
Thank you, Colonel President. Would anybody else on the panel like to add to that?
Well, I think that the whole idea of the, you know, where the budget comes from, what we do with the budget, LROs are a prime example of how we can really squeeze the dollar down and get some amazing results from it. And take a mission that was originally designed. It was the first step in the Constellation program to try and get humans back to the moon. And when it was canceled, we were lucky that they let us still launch. And the mission's just been fantastic. And now I've worked, you know, I don't work the human space flight side, and that's a big chunk of budget. You know, I've worked robotic missions, and LRO is the first time I've been on a mission that we haven't been so budget squeezed, and I'm always worried about whether people are going to maintain their jobs or whether we're going to have to cut staff. Typically, my missions have been very small, and we go from a crew of 10 people and say, well, you know, your budget's been cut, you got to go with half that. And that's where I talked about before, the computer technology has allowed us to be able to go those routes, thankfully. But, you know, it's always hard when you have to turn people away and say, you know, we just can't afford to keep you on. We're going to have to cut the staff. And I have not had to do that with LRO, but that's, you know, part of the resiliency is you have to be able to work towards, you know, maintaining your mission the best of your ability. And it's tough whenever you have an administration changes and the goals change and now you don't know where you stand. So, I mean, even right now, we're hoping that the pendulum's swinging the other way again and that the moon will become, you know, another target. But since we've seen that in the commercial world, that's been, to me, the biggest plus. And a lot of times what I think about when I go to work is that, hey, there are some commercial entities out there that want to get people back to the moon, and our data is going to be critical to them to do that. So that's what gives me more life in my job and going to work every day is to say, hey, maybe this is going to lead to better things. You know, I've been away from the moon for over 40 years. It's time to get back there, and we're leading the path now.
I'd like to just make a comment about that also. Is in the after Apollo 11, the first landing on the moon, I noticed a beginning of a mood shift, if you will, in the U.S. And it wasn't a result of a change of administration. It was a result of a press onslaught, if you will. And it changed from, man, we're going to go to the moon. Well, we went to the moon. Why are we spending so much money on the moon? Well, we didn't spend a dime on the moon. It was all spent in the United States of America. And so we began to push back at that. But NASA got very, very nervous about the status of the program if we continued landing on the moon, and it turned out that we ended up canceling 3 of the missions. Already had the hardware bought, everything was ready to go, just needed an operational budget for these last 3 missions. And they canceled them because of the political environment was changing again, and that was, if we kill somebody on these last 3 missions, the whole deal is over. We're out of business. NASA will never get any more manned space flight. And so they canceled the last 3 missions, put the money in space shuttle, and we didn't kill anybody on the moon. And about this money, you know, we all related to it about the technologies that came out of space exploration. One of the amazing things to me was the software on the Apollo computer had 80K memory. My cell phone has 800,000 times the memory of my Apollo computer. It's right here in my pocket. So that's just one of the things that, you know, we push the exploration and push the challenges of technology.
Dr. Berlinghieri, do you have a follow-up question?
Yes, I have a follow-up question for either Noah or Steve or both. I was fortunate enough to be at the Cape when LRO was launched. I was a guest down there. We had a connection with your additional package, LCROSS. But from what I understand, you were originally going to launch on a Delta. And then all of a sudden, you find that you're going to launch on an Atlas Centaur. And now you have much more lift. And you're starting to drool. You're saying, wow, I've got all that extra payload. What do we do with it? And then all of a sudden, you find, oh, we're going to have to share the space with somebody else. I would like you to, if you can, address your resiliency going from ecstasy to, oh, they're going to be a hazard to us, and how you handle that.
Just to start off, the next time a scientist says no thank you to the opportunity to conduct an impact experiment on the moon will be the first time. the opportunity to bring on the LCROSS mission in conjunction with LRO, again, at the time it was, no one was going to say no to it. There was a concern of this mission creep. We start adding complexity, delaying even further the launch. Now we have to rely on the second mission to happen, to get built, put together. There certainly is a concern that at some point you make things too complicated for their own benefit. But the opportunity, and as I mentioned in my presentation earlier, you know, the opportunity to explore directly, touch the lunar surface with the LCROSS experiment, granted that high velocity, not a controlled landing, you know, presented a unique science opportunity to explore the polar regions of the moon, to look for water, all of which were parts of the LRO sort of objectives. And so any ill feelings or feelings of any additional complexity probably were fairly quickly quelled with the, you know, identification of a really unique opportunity to make a once-in-a-mission lifetime style measurement. Now, it did present additional operational complexities. We had to make sure that we put the spacecraft in a very specific position over the lunar south pole, looking at a target that was changing leading up to the impact itself. And just as a backup, LCROSS was an impact experiment where they directed the empty fuel tank from the launcher into the south pole to kick up material, eject material into space, and then the shepherding spacecraft, the follow-on spacecraft, looked at that material. And the idea was that ice could get lofted up into sunlight from permanent shadow, and we would be able to measure that material that got kicked up, and we sure did, and found ice that had been buried underneath about 3 meters or so below the lunar surface. And so that was one of those pinpoint measurements saying, okay, yes, we know at that point there is 10% water ice buried below the surface. Now, operationally, it presented its own complexities.
Yeah. Now, unfortunately, I wasn't a part of LRO at the time that decision was made. That was done by the development project and, of course, the launch and commissioning phase. And I was just starting to get involved with LRO at the time of the LCROSS impact. But one thing that's trickled down to us now from that decision is with the LRO camera, which is not very radiation hardened. And we see what we call single event upsets fairly frequently that interrupt the data path from that camera into our computer. And so we lose images whenever that occurs. And the reason? Because when LRO was designed, they were so close to their weight margin that they elected not to put the additional shielding on the camera. Well, by the time the decision was made that, oh, we've got excess amount, well, the camera's already designed, built, delivered, and integrated into the spacecraft. So they went with this idea of the LCROSS mission, and we still have the impact to the LROC camera that we don't have the shielding we like to have. So that's a constant thing that we deal with. So that trickle down, and you don't foresee that. It was designed to be a one-year mission. We're 7 years out.
Still getting lots of beautiful images, so.
What I have to keep reminding the PI, Mark Robinson, is, yeah, I'm sorry you're losing your images, but look at what you've got. We've gotten spectacular things.
Okay, what I'd like to do is focus on that second part of the definition of resiliency. Up to this point, we've been talking about the ability to adjust to change. I want to focus on the ability to recover from misfortune. The question I have for the panel is, I'm curious to know how resiliency develops within an individual. For example, is this something that can be taught in class? Is it something that can be trained? Or is it a personality trait? How does one develop resiliency? I'm going to open it up to the panel.
I'll start off because I thought a lot about this on my flight down here. And I'm confident enough to say it in front of all of you friends here today that you could take a course in resiliency and it might be, you know, you might get something out of it, but nobody wakes up in the morning and says, I'm going to be more resilient today. For me, those moments in time and looking back where I say, wow, that really changed how I developed as a person to become the person I did today, was where I left my comfort zone, where I got out of my grid, where I took on a responsibility or did something different. And I think of two examples when I was in college. One, I took on a radio show. And you want to learn resiliency. Operating a radio show in Lewiston, Maine at 3 o'clock in the morning in the dead of winter. You got people calling all the time who have enjoyed themselves a little bit too much on a Friday night. Toughens you up a little bit. If I can do this, I can handle so-and-so or whatever it is. And again, that was not something I planned on doing. That was not part of the path that I saw towards my future. But I had an opportunity to do something different, and I took it. And it changed my comfort in talking in front of not just people at 3 o'clock in the morning in Lewiston, Maine, but you know, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in Charleston, South Carolina. The other was working with a women's volleyball team. And you might think, wow, that sounds like a pretty plush job in college. It was. But it also came with unexpected complications. Like, my weekends were shot. But to be responsible for 12 other people who looked to me to make sure that they had clean laundry the next morning, I learned how to do my own laundry. I learned where every washing machine in New England was at 3 o'clock in the morning. But it put me in a position where I had to do things that made me take on challenges and not be afraid to take on those challenges. And again, those are not things that were in a class or in a manual or in a seminar or anything like that. Those were just life choices where I said, well, this would be an interesting opportunity. I mean, I did the volleyball thing just because I wanted to graduate and get my PE credits done. And it opened the world to me to these ideas of leadership. And so I think, you know, when you look for, you know, recovering from misfortune, you know, misfortune comes in many different formats. It's just challenges that you have to face and how you are skilled to do that. Just, you know, again, not in a class, but just something you take on and say, this is going to be fun. Let's see how this turns out. You know, that works or doesn't. But unless you put yourself into those positions where you're changing your comfort zone, I don't think you'll ever become resilient.
I think that in the satellite world, when I first went into training, and I think there's a two-part to that. I think there are certain things you want to try and learn, probably from like a classroom environment, about how you handle misfortune and how you can personally respond. And then there's the aspect that you never really know until you go through it. So the idea is that you try and put yourself into a position where you're experiencing misfortune in a very controlled environment. So when I was in satellite operations training, they asked us the question the first day. When you're sitting there looking at your telemetry screen and you see something go wrong with the spacecraft, what's the first thing you do? And of course, we're sitting there staring back at this guy. We've never even looked at a telemetry screen before. Didn't know what the heck it was. Maybe it depends on what the problem is. You know, first thing you do is you sit back and take a breath. Okay, that makes sense. So then, over the course of the years, as we're preparing for GPS launches, we run through simulations one after the other, so just ad nauseum, and they're throwing problems at you all the time just to see how you respond. And we had a general one time tell the local newspaper that our teams are prepared for every possible contingency. We've practiced everything that can conceivably go wrong with the spacecraft. And all of us in our control room thought, well, that was a dumb statement, because by the time we launched three spacecraft and we've been through hundreds of rehearsals, we'd rehearsed all these problems, but the ones that really came up were never one we'd rehearsed before. Every problem was something that we'd never seen or even thought would occur. But by going through that training, though, you knew how to respond. And so you have to be, like, you put in the artificial position to experience misfortune when, you know, regardless of how you respond, you're not going to hurt anything. That's what helps you, that when things really do go wrong, you can perform the way you need to perform and get things fixed and not lose a spacecraft.
General Dick?
I think you could probably, all of those things you mentioned about resiliency, how it comes about, but in my mind, I sort of agree with Steve. I think our training is paramount. You've got to know how things operate, and you've got to be able to respond with training calmly rather than panic. If you let fear or doubt rule, you're dead. And so you need to understand the spacecraft totally. And we knew in our training in Apollo, especially in the landing, the simulator instructor could kid you if you were 10 feet off the ground and he put a certain fade in. And you know, if that happened to you, you were a dead hero. But if it happened at 20 feet, you could recover if you did the right thing. And so we learned the spacecraft and the procedures over and over and over, and also the emergency procedures, so that we were able to, when it happened, we were able to respond quickly. And we did the same thing with mission control in our simulations, where mission control's in Houston, we're in Florida, the simulator, and we go through these various areas of the mission, and the whole purpose is to mission control simulator suit was to fail this mission. And so they put in all of these failures, and how did you overcome? And then we would debrief that. And so I found that to overcome misfortune in setbacks in real life was to be as well trained as you could in before you got there. And in Apollo, we had a lot of misfortune. Apollo 13 was the biggest. Apollo 11 had a lot of problems. Computer problems, communication problems, fuel problems. We came within 17 seconds of calling an abort on Apollo because of a trajectory problem. On Apollo 13, the tanks blew up, as I mentioned earlier. And how did we recover from that? Fortunately, through training, through ingenuity, and just old common sense, we were able to recover the spacecraft. So I give all the credit, not all the credit, but most of the credit to the training that we received and the thoroughness of that.
Colonel Bresnik, do you have anything to add?
I think certainly, you know, you asked the question whether or not we're born with it. I think certainly I will agree that people can be active and be passive. That's just their natural personality. I think you're looking out in the audience there and the people that would be in attendance here at the Citadel, the majority of the folks here today are probably more towards the active side of the scale. People willing to, you know, students, you have the Citadel cadets that are out there PTing in the afternoons or the mornings while compatriots at other schools are sitting there playing video games and eating bonbons. But you know, that's a choice that people can make. And so the question comes down to this training and this reaction of, well, what about when you don't have the choice? And certainly we can all understand, especially in this environment of the Citadel, the example of in the military, when the first time that rounds are coming downrange inbound and you're taking rounds for the first time, you're being shot at for the first time, people react differently. And who the person you thought was the biggest, toughest, strongest person that was going to be out leading the charge against, you know, in the hail of enemy gunfire, maybe the person who is frozen with fear, and it's the quiet, unassuming person that, you know, you forgot their name in training, that picks up the rifle and follows their training and advances to the sound of the guns. The same thing, as you can see, General Duke and Steve mentioned, we do the same thing in spaceflight with training. And it's typically not the failures that cause the most problem. It's when you make the mistakes and you have to overcome the mistakes. Knowing that you made this mistake that caused this failure, how do you overcome that and be able to compartmentalize all of that and then proceed to pick up the pieces and continue forward? And that's where training, whether it's in the military or at NASA or anywhere else, is great, because the clock keeps going, the airplane keeps flying, the rounds keep coming down range. You can't just hit the pause button like on a video game and stop and think about it. You've got to be able to go, okay, well, what do we do next, and press on. And that's something you get through training. And certainly something that we've been very good at in our military and in our space program at doing with people, and making people that are, whether they're active or passive, be able to respond properly in the needed environment simply be through the training that they've had.
Thank you, Colonel Breslin. Dr. Berlingeri is going to bring Cadet McNerney into this conversation
yes,
now.
Yes, I certainly am. I have a follow-up question on this topic. Cadet McNerney transferred into physics, I think in the sophomore year. And during the semester, she had a really serious bicycle accident that took her out of commission for quite some time. So first of all, she's taking on the challenge of transferring into physics. You might say the bicycle accident knocks some sense into her head. Why would she go into physics? But she decided to come, and we got a very, very good student. But here's a tragedy that occurs right in the middle of a semester. She's in the honors program. She's taking on all these extra duties. How do you accommodate an injury, an unexpected injury, and still be able to do as well as you've done? Can you address that?
Absolutely. So this was this is actually towards the end of the semester, right before finals hit, during finals, excuse me. My friends and I are going on a bike ride to blow off some steam, and I am terrible with vehicles. And I fell off my bike on the Cooper River Bridge, broke my wrist, scabbed up my face pretty bad, broke a couple toes. It ended up delaying my training over the summer for Air Force. All cadets are required to go to field training, which time varies, but it usually is about a month long. Then when I returned that first junior semester, that was my second semester as an academic physics major. And quite frankly, it was a big semester. I mean, we started getting into upper-level math courses, difficult things that I'd never seen before. And that's also when, you know, the leadership positions at the school get very intensive as far as responsibilities are concerned. That semester, that year, I was Victor Company First Sergeant, which it moves from being a very followership-oriented role as a sophomore corporal to this new sergeant position, where suddenly you have people that you have to take care of, you have people that you have to make sure they're getting to the things that they need to get to, instead of just making sure yourself is situated. So due to that bike accident, I was not wearing a helmet. I was pretty dumb for not doing that, but I hit my head pretty hard, and I struggled with a lot of my math courses that semester. And for myself, I pride myself on my academics. Up until that point, I had, I think, an overall cumulative grade point average of something like a 3.7. And that semester, I didn't. My grades definitely suffered. But something that made me do was look at myself and look at my identity and what I saw in myself. And I had to expand myself from just an academic perspective. I started to join extracurricular groups. I started to focus on building bonds and friendships at the school that sometimes I had neglected because I was so focused on academics. Academics are, of course, incredibly important, but nonetheless, I think a lot of my resiliency from that semester has come from building up other areas of my life, because you never know when something's going to get taken away from you, whether it's your ability to do math, which since then I have fortunately recovered, but having other areas in your life and putting effort and dedication to the people around you, to the people that can hold you up during those times of failure and misfortune, that's what's helped me to develop resiliency. So I'll just say about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question. has to do with attending military colleges. Four of our five panelists have attended military college, and I'm wondering whether that experience and training that you received at a military college influenced your resiliency. And I'm going to toss it back to Cadet McNerney to talk about that.
Absolutely. The Citadel is obviously a unique institution. And I think, you know, during the first year at the Naval Academy or Air Force Academy, they all have such a plebe year. Here we call it NOB year. And you're really forced into positions that you've never been in before. It's a position of servitude. You're expected to do things that otherwise, you know, if you're a senior in high school, you're at the top and now you're at the bottom again. And again, it forces you to rely on the people around you and build bonds that, you know, I can rely on any of my classmates. They'd have my back in a second. And for me, a big part of my growth and resiliency came from, I mean, I'm still independent, but being able to reach out to others and depend on them. I consider myself an introvert. Because of that, sometimes I can close myself off. I can try to do things all on my own. And in a system like this, you can't. You need to rely on your teammates, your classmates, your peers, you know, your fellow sergeants when you're a rank holder or even the, you know, your subordinates all the time, too. Right now, as a company commander, I need to rely on my subordinates to get their job done, and I can't do it all myself. So, in a lot of ways, again, my resiliency has come from that need to depend on others.
Colonel Bresnik, do you have thoughts on that?
I'm sure that General Duke was a really good student at the Naval Academy, and I certainly tried to be one at the Citadel, but for me, the Citadel was amazing. I had to grow up. I was fortunate to receive a Marine Corps scholarship, but the pivotal event for me was my junior year. And I screwed up. I made a mistake, and I got in trouble because we have, you know, rules that you can't break. And so the Assistant Commandant of Cadets, Colonel Harvey Dick, held my feet to the fire and held me accountable, and I got busted, and I was a junior private for, part of my junior year. And then I ended up starting the senior year as a senior private. Not exactly what most, you know, military cadets hope for. Certainly not what I had planned or wanted. But the decision I made got me in trouble, and I was held accountable. And that alone, aside from all the other great leadership examples and opportunities I had and the friends that I made at the Citadel, that was the one thing that really forced me to perhaps change my attitude or grow up enough that for the rest of my career, nothing like that was ever going to happen again. And I was never going to be put in the situation. I was never going to allow myself to, you know, think the thoughts that would allow that to happen. And I was not going to screw up if I had anything to say about it. And I wouldn't have gotten that opportunity to recover from it had I not been at the Citadel with the system that it had. And, you know, finished my senior year off the way I did. You know, because nowadays with the zero defects mentality you see in too many places, you make one screw up and you're done. And I learned from that screw up and became better for it, and that's what I have the school to thank for.
Thank you. General Duke?
I think resiliency in one respect, I can remember a time in I grew up in Lancaster, South Carolina, and when I was a 10th grader, I wanted to go to the Naval Academy, but I couldn't get into the Naval Academy out of Lancaster High School. They just didn't have the courses that would prepare me for the exams. So I went off to a boarding school, Admiral Farragut Academy in St. Petersburg, Florida, at 15, and I did my junior and senior year at Admiral Farragut Academy, and I mean that was really a change and setback, if you will. Here I am, don't know how to march, don't know how to salute, don't know how to do anything, but I'm down at this school to learn the academics. But it turned out to be a great advantage for me because I learned how to march, I learned how to make a bed, I learned how to be salute, I learned how to yes sir, no sir, learn discipline, and so the academy was a good influence for me, Admiral Farragut Academy. So when I got to the Naval Academy, I found that my plebe year was a lot easier than it would have been had I not had that opportunity 2 years at Farragut. So I look back now and I'm very thankful that my parents sacrificed a lot to send me off to this private school. And it turned out to be a good foundation for my military career.
Thank you. Dr. Berlinger, you have a follow-up question for one
of
your
former students? Yes, I have a follow-up question for my other student. Steve was one of my students, and you said you were 30 years, is that right? 30, we'll forget that. He was a recent student of mine, but in the physics department, we teach fundamental courses, all basic, all mostly theory, some applied. In looking at what we provided for you, there was probably nothing in there that would help you as a mission director. So I guess what I'm asking you is, were you able to... one other thing I wanted to say before I pass it over. All of his successes I take credit for. But, having said that, were you able to find what you needed in those fundamental courses, or were you able to have the resiliency to know where to get it so that you could be obviously a successful mission director?
Yes, it's a combination of all of that. I think that my education at the Citadel has a number of factors that influence me through my career. One is of course, that the Citadel has always prided itself on preparing you to handle stress. And that's largely, like I said before, about putting you in an artificially stressful environment so that you have to know and learn the resiliency to respond to stressful situations. As far as my background in physics here, the most basic physics courses that teach you are about angular momentum. This is one thing I struggle with, just to talk to people about how satellites work in space and how we point a spacecraft. I mean, LRO will talk about that. It was designed to do a mission where it looks down at the moon and maps the moon, and it would slew off angle just occasionally to do calibrations. And what we do now is slew it up to 7 times a day to go look at targets with different angles and things like that. And we do that with reaction wheels on board the spacecraft. By spinning those reaction wheels and making them go faster or slower, the spacecraft reacts in the opposite way, and we can find that spacecraft. But over time, angular momentum builds up, and we need to dump that off. Earth-orbiting spacecraft have a means of interacting with the Earth's magnetic field to torque the spacecraft and slow the wheel speeds down and reduce the angular momentum. On our spacecraft, we have to use thrusters. But when I try to explain that to people who don't have a physics background, they look at me like, what are you talking about? Well, just by the fact that I had courses in Newtonian physics and what angular momentum is, then we translate into the spacecraft and they're describing to me why we need to do these maneuvers, it all makes sense. So the background's there to help me understand just the basics of what's going on with the spacecraft. And there are numerous other examples of how spacecraft work. We never learned about orbit dynamics here at the Citadel, but it took a week-long course and I understood the basics of what I needed to know understand what our orbits are like and how we change from one orbit to another. Now, I can't plan that. That would take a whole in-depth set of study that I don't have, but I understand at least basically what's going on, and that allows me to effectively manage the mission on a day-to-day basis. So, the Citadel definitely gave me all the background I needed to be successful. And yes, you can take credit for that.
All right, I think on that note, we're going to pause for a minute or two. Those cadets who need to get to their next class or finish up laboratory, now would be a great time to get up and leave. I'm going to open up the panel to audience questions. The only way Colonel Bresnik can hear us is if we talk through microphones. And so there's a stand-up microphone over here on the right side of the auditorium. If you'd like to ask any of the panel members, including Colonel Bresnik in Russia, a question, I'd like you to go ahead and line up on the right side of the auditorium here, and I'm going to go ahead and put a microphone over there.
Joe Sislow. I'm class of 61, so I'm much older than most people around here, with the exception of the Brigadier. And I've worked on space programs through Air Force Systems Command. So my question is for mostly with respect to the astronaut in Russia and the NASA guys here. We have another space race going on. That other space race, and I'd like to know what your feeling is to the results of this, or the possible results of this, the private sector in the space race of launch vehicles.
Launch vehicles is not my area of expertise. To me, in the satellite business, the launches are right. Once that's done, we're done. But, personally, I think getting the commercial sector involved in space is the only way we're really going to go anywhere in space. I mean, that's what, when you think about Christopher Columbus coming over to America, he didn't do it just to explore. He was looking for the economic benefit, and we need to have economic benefit or we're going to be earthbound. So I think the more we get the commercial sector involved, the better it's going to be. And I've worked commercial satellites before, too. It's a different type of stress in that environment over what we're doing in research. Dollars at stake. Of course, that's still not quite like having humans at stake. But yeah, I'm much in favor of getting the commercial aspect in there. I just love the fact that we've got commercial entities wanting to return to the moon and send people to the moon and build mining or bases on the moon to exploit the resources that we have there. And I keep saying the more that we can deliver on LRO to help them know what resources are there, help them exploit those resources, the happier I am. Much in favor of that.
In the early days of commercialization of space, I saw it more of the idea of NASA's never. Well, let me first off, NASA never built anything. We didn't build Apollo. We didn't build Mercury. We didn't build anything. The commercial side of it built the things, but NASA had a set of requirements for Apollo, for instance. This thing's got to go to the moon, it's got to carry three people, it's got to land, it's got to, et cetera, et cetera. And they said, you build it. And so the companies came back and said, yeah, we can build it, and NASA picked the one. And the commercial side, as I saw it when it first started, there was seven or eight companies came to NASA, says, this is what we got, do you want to buy it? And NASA said, well, we'll have a competition. And they did a competition, and it was SpaceX and Orbital and Boeing and several others. And so NASA then gave them contracts to say, okay, we'll buy what you made, and you can take our cargo to the space station. Now it's expanded, and I agree with Steve. It's really, really exciting to see what these ideas that these guys have got to take people to the moon, take them into orbit, unencumbered, if you will, with some of the regulations that the government has to put up with, and so they're press it on, and I think it's going to be very, very exciting, the future with the commercial side of it.
Just to add to it, you know, we get the question in the astronaut office, well, what do you guys think about this commercial crew stuff? And it seems like a lot of time we get the question, they expect us to go, well, we don't like it, we want our Orion, all that kind of stuff. And it couldn't be farther from the truth. I mean, we want everybody to succeed wildly, because if you're involved in the space business and you want to see success in moon and humans expand our presence in the solar system, you know, we're not going to get it with a single sole provider. And you know, when you look at the fact that we did compete for this commercial crew stuff, and we have not only one, but two companies that have landed the first stages back on Earth that can be reused, that alone, that thing right there is going to be the linchpin that changes space dramatically in our future. That's going to be like the transistor that General Duke talked about, reading about back at MIT. That is going to completely change the whole ballgame. And when it's kind of like when aviation back in the early 1900s, when we had a few airplanes, and all of a sudden we got in, we started having the commercial aviation, the airmail and all that. Look where we are today with commercial aviation. You know, by letting other companies and people that had ideas go out and build stuff, fly it, and then we end up, you know, with many, many companies all competing, trying to provide a service. And I think, like everybody said, we're up for an amazing time in spaceflight. We're going to reduce the cost, and that'll be the landing the first stage is a really huge step in that regard.
Thank you. Next question.
My name is Dave Kaiser, and I'm an 81 grad in the company, and I'm a neurophysiologist. And I run a research program for the Department of Defense in traumatic brain injury and PTSD. I've got a compliment, a couple of comments, and a question, if you give me some time. The compliment comes from the fact that I have witnessed over the past 5 years the Department of Defense has rolled out these resilience training programs that they have instituted, most of them with very limited success. And I think one of the problems is they never answered the question, resilience to what? And as this panel started off, you clearly identified this is going to be resilience to space operations, right? From the administrative to the budgetary, all the way up to putting the man on the moon. We have kind of tailed away from that, though, as the discussions has played on through the day, right? And what I want to present is that resilience comes in many flavors, and that the basis of resilience, much like the basis in training that the Department of Defense and every military body knows, right? But the basis behind all of this is a change in physiology. We change our own physiology when we train. We change our physiology when we try to anticipate and know what it is that we're going to do at any given moment. That builds a certain level of resilience to a certain type of change. But we have to constantly be asking that question, change to what? What are we building resilience to? And my last comment before I'll throw it out to the panel for comment is that we need to be careful, because resiliency comes in many different flavors, and particularly when you talk about the battlefield, there are certain resiliencies that we do not want to nurture, right? So resilience is not always a good thing. We've talked about them in the context where they are, but there are certain contexts that they are not, and we need to be aware of that. We need to get curious about how we optimize the physiology behind the resilience that really is what we are looking to achieve here. And before I ask my question, I will let the panel comment if they wish. Okay. My question is relatively simple. Mark Kelly and his brother went up. I was wondering if anybody could report on any resilience type findings that they have seen from their tremendous experience.
Are both medical doctors, so you might talk to the other doctor. But I know that the first part, you know, that's
The results from that study, that one-year on-orbit study, I mean, they're just starting to come out now, and it's still going to be time for any of the sort of long-term effects to come out of that result, out of that study. And, you know, there's going to have to be